So if you're like me, you probably have at least a few bad habits you would like to break, but it's tough because no matter how hard I try, I seem to slip back into the same old routines again and again.
In the last decade, we've learned a lot about how habits work.
That's Charles Duhigg, author of the book, The Power of Habit.
And in particular, we've learned the neurological structure of a habit.
He says that we tend to think of habits as a single thing, but actually...
Each habit has three components. There's a cue, which is like a trigger for a behavior to start. And then there's a routine, which is the behavior itself. And then finally, a reward, which is how our brain learns to encode that automatic behavior for the future. And one of the big differences is that for years when people thought about habits, they focused in on the routine, on the behavior. But what we now know is that it's these cues and these rewards that really shape how habits occur and how to change them.
And Charles says that whether we like it or not, this kind of habit formation is endemic to our brain.
And what it will do is our brain will latch onto a cue that it associates with a behavior and a particular reward. And over time, that cue and that reward become more and more and more sort of intertwined. A particular part of your brain named the basal ganglia will relate them together. And the behavior that's associated with that, that will just sort of happen automatically.
But Charles says the good news is we can also use this knowledge to our advantage.
There was a big study that was done about how to create exercise habits. And so what they did is they told a group of people, okay, first of all, choose an obvious cue. Always go running at the same time every day, or put your workout clothes next to your bed so that you see them first thing when you wake up. And then they said, and then go for a run or go work out. And when you get back from exercising, give yourself a small piece of chocolate. Now, this is kind of counterintuitive, right? Because people who are exercising are trying to lose weight, not eat more chocolate. And yet what the researchers knew is that their brain needed that reward. Their basal ganglia needed some reward. And what they found was that people who ate a small piece of chocolate after coming home from a run or a workout, they were much more likely to start exercising habitually.
So according to Charles, whether you want to break a habit or start a new habit, the key is to divide the habit into its component parts, cue, routine, and reward, and design it for the result that you want.
Hey, thanks for checking out West Church Online. We're so glad that you have taken a few minutes out of your day to hear what we are talking about right now. We are talking about the power of habit. When Jesus was walking around and teaching and healing and being with his people here on earth, right before he knew that he was going to not be here any longer, he said, look, all the power that I have, and you can do so much more. We don't talk about that. It feels a little weird, but we believe those words, that the power that he had from being connected to God, the power that's bigger than we are, is the same power that we have. So today we are going to talk about the power of habits, and I hope that you will find meaning and transformational insights in this message. If you are newer to the West community, we would love to know that you are checking out this message. You can text the word welcome to the number that you see on your screen right now. Text the word welcome. We have a gift that we will send you, and then following that gift, you can choose whether you opt in to communication or not. We invite you to follow us on our social media platforms. You'll see those linked on our YouTube page in the comments after this message. But we're so glad that you've taken a few minutes to check this out. Now let's dive into the power of habit. So when we got ready for this message series, we put out on our social media platforms the question, when you hear this phrase, what do you think of? The power of. And habit was one of the answers that you shared, the power of habit. Do you have any habits? We would love, if you are worshiping with us in our live stream platform, we would love for you to type in the chat room right now with Lexi, our growth co-pastor. We'd love for you to tell her what some of your habits are. We all have habits. It's something that we do over and over again. We do repeatedly. We do whether we think about it or not. In fact, scientific research shows that 40% of our behaviors are actually just habit, like we don't even think about it. And so I would invite you for just a few minutes to think about the power of habit. I want you to take a look on the screen at the habit loop. You see in the middle of the screen, it says craving, like we all have cravings for things, whether we recognize it or not. And believe it or not, some of the things that we crave are not actually tied to that. And so I want you to look at the craving in the middle and remember that that's what drives our habits. And then there's a cue. This is what triggers our brain to do something. And then we have the routine, and that is the action or behavior that goes along with that cue. And then always there is a reward. Now, we're going to leave this image on the screen while I talk about these next few things. So I want you to think about what habits you have. So for me, a habit that I have that I'm not exactly proud of is Diet Mountain Dew. I've done better about that because I saw on TikTok, which is the source of all relevant information, that there are countries that don't even sell Mountain Dew because of some damaging chemical in it. I'm like, oh, well, that's good. If there are other places in the world that don't sell it, perhaps I do not need to consume as much of it. So I'm trying to wean myself off that habit and lean on other diet beverages. And please don't email me how bad they are for me. But the reason that I have the Diet Mountain Dew is not, you know, because I just crave the Diet Mountain Dew. I crave the pep and the energy that the caffeine gives me. And so, like, I crave energy first thing in the morning. And sometimes, like, if life's going good and things are clipping along, I can have that energy organically. Like, I can wake up and be like, oh, yay, new day, great. And then there are other times, like, I'm tired and I need that. So some of the things that we think we crave are not really what we crave. We crave something much deeper. And I invite you to read the Atomic Habits book or The Power of Habit. Both of those are phenomenal reads. And we're going to tie this into spirituality in just a second because the two things do, believe it or not, go together. But I invite you to take a look at what they say some of the things that we crave are. Like, some of the things that we do not because of the cue that we think. We do it because of some deeper reason. And they share all different kinds of studies in the research. But like one example is this one of the authors of the book, he decided that he was going to explore the habit of eating a cookie. And so he started eating a cookie every day at a certain time. And then his wife's like, you know, hey, look, your waistline is expanding exponentially. Could you maybe think about a new, different kind of habit? And once he tried to break his cookie habit, he found that he had really become dependent on the habit. So look back now at the image on your screen. Like, he thought he was just craving the cookie and that was the cue. Like, oh my gosh, I want something sweet. Or maybe the habit is, and the cue is, I'm hungry. And so he started doing different things to try to break that. The point of today's message is for us to acknowledge our habits, recognize which ones are good and which ones aren't. What can we do to break the habit if it's a bad habit? And how does our faith play a part in that? So, you know, whatever it is that we're craving, like the guy thought it's either the sweets or I'm hungry. And so he tried to do different things. So at 3:30 every day, at first he thought, okay, I'm going to see if it's that I'm craving something sweet. So he tried to get fruit and thinking that the sugar in the fruit would replace the sugar of the cookie. And then it's so important to remember that, like, what is the reward? You know, like, do you get that craving satisfied? And ultimately, if you do, then it feels like a reward. And that's what makes us keep doing it. It is the reward that creates the habit. Because if we don't get something out of something, then we stop doing it. That is human nature, okay? Think about that one more time. If we're doing something and we don't get anything out of it, we won't keep doing it. But if we do, if we get whatever we're craving, then we will keep doing it over and over again. And that's what creates a habit. So he tried to eat an apple. It didn't work. His reward was not fulfilled. He did not subside that craving. So then he started eating different things, trying to see if it would fulfill that craving for him, and it didn't. So then he tried something different. He tried to go and buy a cup of coffee. You know, maybe it's that I need to get up and go somewhere, and that still didn't make him better. What he found ultimately after many different tries and different experiments was that what he was really craving was community. It had nothing to do with the cookie. It had to do with the fact that when he would go get the cookie every time, he would spend 15 minutes in the break room with the other staff. And he was a news reporter. And so when he would go to the break room, they would spend 15 minutes gossiping about whatever the new news was. And so when he would go buy the coffee or he'd go try the apple or whatever, those things did not satisfy the craving because he had identified the wrong craving. He thought it was about the food. And ultimately, it was about his need for community and conversation. So once he realized what his ultimate craving was and what the reward was, he found that at 3:30, if he would go into the break room every day and have a conversation without anything to drink, anything to eat, he was fine. His cookie weight went away, and he found that he was actually very happy. So I want us to think about what our habits are. And I want you to take a look at this quote. Habits have a powerful impact on our lives. It is important that we identify the positive ones and the negative ones. And honestly, that's what I think our role as a faith community can be, is to help provide positive opportunities for habit formation. Next week, we're going to talk about spiritual disciplines and that there are legitimate things that we can do in our lives. And if we'll do them intentionally, there's like 12 different ones. If we'll do them intentionally, then our lives will be richer and we can develop those into habits. And like meditation, that's a discipline. Fasting is a discipline. But it's really important for us to think about what our positive habits are and what our negative ones are. So back to the Diet Mountain Dew and that. The reward is that I feel this pick-me-up. And so what I've started to do is associate that, like, when I do this, I feel this way. And so now what I've noticed, if, like, it's a really stressful day at work, my reward is a soda. You know, like a diet soda. I'll go get one and I'll be like, okay, now I can handle or tackle whatever is in front of me. That's not a healthy habit. If you want to find out more about this video, it talks about how you can see what you're craving and the cue and the routine and the reward. We're going to put a link to that video in the notes comment under this message. It's the video that we showed at the beginning of this message. But it's important to watch that because guess what? Once we identify what we're craving and what our cue is, we can figure out other ways to get the reward and then change the middle part. We can change our routine, and then that makes things better. Aristotle says, we are what we repeatedly do. We are what we repeatedly do. What do you do over and over again? Are you a person of kindness? Are you a person of love? Are we people of positive words and affirmation? Are we people of criticism? Are we people of judgment? Are we people of selfishness? Are we people of greed? Are we people of generosity? I mean, what are we? We are what we repeatedly do. Yesterday, we had the Back to School Bash. It's something that West founded 12 years ago, right before we launched as a campus of Williamson's Chapel. We launched it in conjunction with them, and then over the last 12 years, it's become its own 501c3. It's called Inspire Our Children, and Inspire Our Children hosts the Back to School Bash. West is a huge, huge, huge part of that. It is a part of our DNA, and for the past 12 years, hundreds of volunteers have gathered to offer in a fun festival-like atmosphere free school supplies, free backpacks, free brand new tennis shoes. We wash the children's feet and have conversation with them. This year, thanks to a generous donation of a sponsor, we gave away Bash t-shirts to everyone that came. And everybody that came got a brand new, like, Back to School Bash t-shirt, which hopefully has empowered everyone to be just a part of this community event. And the whole point was that no one would ever be made to feel lesser than, because they needed a little help to start back to school. When I taught school before I went in ministry 25 years ago, I taught at a school that was a Title I school, which means the majority of the students were on free and reduced lunch. Like 75% of our kids were on free and reduced lunch. And so what I learned my first year of teaching was that the kids would come to school and not have what they needed. And nobody wants to go up to the teacher on the first or second day of school and say, Mrs. Smith, I need like some paper or a pencil, and the embarrassment. And then the kids that come in with their brand new clothes and shoes and backpacks, and then those that didn't have the opportunity to have that. It was out of that that we had the idea to provide a festival so everybody could come and have fun. It's been going on for 12 years, and you're going to see a video in a few minutes about that. Josh had an interaction yesterday with somebody that's just, it talks about the power of habit, and it gives proof that habits can be positive and amazing things. But as we were leaving yesterday, there were two volunteers, and they had on a Back to School Bash shirt from like 2015. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I knew I recognized you. I said, thank you for being here. And they're like, we serve every single year. We wouldn't miss it. Like, this is just a part of who we are, is something we do over and over again, because it brings us so much joy to be able to work with people. Now, what are our habits? Are our habits working with others and serving others and doing good in the world? Or are our habits geared only around ourselves? It needs to be both and. Like, we need some habits that bring us personal joy and fulfillment. But this is actually where we go into the spiritual realm. Aristotle's quote, we are what we repeatedly do. Jesus gave very clear commands on who we are to be. And so the passage of scripture that has been like our anchor passage for this series, The Power of Habits, it's come from Romans 12, because the Apostle Paul, he's the one who came right after Jesus and had this Damascus Road powerful moment and encountered Jesus. And then he started going and teaching and launching churches. And he was telling everybody like what they needed to do so that they could be like Jesus, so that their habits would be such that Jesus also did and called us to do. So that's where we marry the scientific realm and the power of habits into our spiritual world and our faith understanding. Aristotle says, we are what we repeatedly do. Jesus shows us how to be our best selves and how to be amazing and fulfilled by doing things that are geared toward a certain way. Now, there's one more thing that I want us to understand, and habits are dependent on our willpower. We each have this thing called willpower, and sometimes we have a lot of it, and sometimes we do not. But it's important to remember, and you need to think about this every single day when you wake up. We have a limited amount of willpower. It's a limited amount every single day. When I studied that this week, some things made sense to me. So, like, I'm not ashamed that I have, I call it an adult beverage. I do not have them in excess, but, you know, like I'll have a glass of wine at the end of the day. I'll associate it with cooking or whatever. And what I've realized is like there are calories in wine. So when I started having more wine, the scale started having more numbers. And I'm like, this is not good. Like I need to stop this habit and, you know, limit it to, you know, only two times a week or something like that. And I found that it was really hard to do. So then I panicked. I'm like, oh my gosh, do I have an addiction? Because there is a very, very significant and clear line between a habit and an addiction. And alcohol is an addiction or can be an addiction. And I want to make sure that I never, you know, go into that realm. Well, what I realized was the times that I would want or feel like I needed or craved a glass of wine would be the days at the end of the day when I was spent and like I just didn't have any more to give emotionally or mentally or intellectually. That would be when I would be like, oh, I want this, because it would, you know, when I would have that, it would be a reward for myself, because like for 2/3 of my life, I never drank at all. And so like, it's a little bit of a forbidden privilege. And so I'm like, that's what it is. Like, it's a reward when I feel down or sad or exhausted, because my energy and my willpower is gone. And so instead of wine or an adult beverage, now I substitute ginger ale, diet ginger ale. That's my little go-to. I put it in my little fancy cup and I sit down and watch mindless TV on Netflix. And you know what? That's not a bad habit, but it replaced what could have become a very, very bad habit. But it's important to know, look, we're all created with this energy and this power, but it isn't infinite. Like, we get to a place in our journeys, in our days, in our weeks, in our months, in our years, that sometimes the energy that we have within us, it just feels spent. And that's when it's important to remember that we're not dependent on ourselves for that energy. First of all, we have to recognize that it's okay to say, I just need some time and I need a break. I can't do this anymore. I just need to take a few steps away and I need to replenish my energy and my willpower. And that's why we're going to talk about spiritual disciplines next week, because that's the how that we do that. But it's also important to remember the power of prayer, the power of asking other people to lift us up, to hold us in their energy and their light so that we can replenish our depleted supplies of willpower. And it's also important to remember that the power that we have, it comes from within. God lies within each of us. God is not a human being. God's not on some big chair far, far away with a long white beard. God, the power of God, the power of love lives in each of us. So we as followers of Christ call it the Holy Spirit. And when we feel empty, it is okay to admit that and then just go within and ask God, ask the power of God to fill us with what we need. And then that will help us find the willpower that we need. Now, I told you that our anchor passage for this message series is taken from the book of Romans. Paul is very clear on how we can live in such a way that we form the habits that are going to give us that reward that we seek. And that's why I think there's something to this whole thing of Christianity. Not to get wrapped up in the dogma and the polity and whether you believe in this or the literal statements or the metaphorical statements. Like, the overall message of Christianity and the message of science, they merge. Because like, energy is a real thing. Last 2 weeks ago, if you watched the message, we talked about quantum physics and the energy you put out is the energy that you receive back. And so I've started paying attention to that. And it's so true. When we carry positivity and love, the speaker that we talked about, like she said, you need to aim for love or above on the kinesthetic scale of energy. Love, peace, and joy, those are the top. And so when you try to focus focus on those things, that's what you get back. If you stay down in the anger or the grief or the dismay or the fear, then when you put that out, it's what you get back. Like the Apostle Paul, he didn't know what quantum physics was, but he knew that if we lived our lives like Jesus lived, that something really powerful happened. And so I want to share with you very, very specifically today what those steps are. We're not just going to fly through the passage. I really want you to look on the screen. I want you to see the words, and I want you to commit them to heart. This is Romans chapter 12. I invite you just to look at the whole chapter on your own, but these are some things that we should commit to our memory. First, love from the center of who you are. Love from the center of who you are. Like, don't fake it. You know, there's a phrase, fake it till you make it. And sometimes you may have to pretend because it may just not feel like it's in there. But what if from the very center of who we are love? Then listen, that makes all the difference in the world. Like, that just creates this amazing energy and positivity. The next thing, if it doesn't lead to love, then we understand or call it evil or sin. Sin means missing the mark. Hamartia is the Greek word. And so sin means missing the mark. That's also called evil. If it doesn't lead to love, then the opposite of that would be sin, darkness, evil. Run from it. Like, if we look at our actions and we think, okay, is this going to be an act of love or is this going to be an act of something else? Am I acting out of my woundedness? Am I acting out of my exhaustion? Am I acting out of my anger or my fear? If it's any of those things, let it alone. Run from that. Cling to only that which is good. And I loved this next, and this really is in the Bible. All right, it says very plainly in Romans 12, no cursing under your breath. Now, I've tried to rationalize that as I've studied it, and they did not say out loud. Like, but in other places in Scripture, it says, you know, may your mouth be pure and not profane. But, you know, like, we shouldn't go around grumbling and cursing under our breath and being negative. When my children were growing up, one of the pet peeves for me is a rolling of the eyes. Now, that would get them in trouble quicker than anything else in the world when I would say something and they would roll their eyes because it was such a sign of disrespect. So no rolling of the eyes, no cursing under our breath. Like, it needs to be out there. We need to be honest. We need to be transparent. And it's okay to be vocal in a kind way about the things that bother us, right? Because life's not always perfect. But the snide stuff and the behind the scenes stuff, it's just not okay. Paul says, no cursing under your breath. And then he says, all right, you need to get along with others and you don't need to be stuck up. Do you ever find yourself wanting to be stuck up, like, I'm just a little bit better than this situation or than they are? And that is not okay. When I first began ministry, I was so excited. I taught school for a couple of years and then moved to Ashe County to do administration in technology and computers. That was the longest 9 months of my life. It was not what I was called or created to do. And during that time, I really felt called to ministry. I had become a United Methodist, and they acknowledged women in ministry, unlike my Baptist heritage. And so I began conversations around what it would mean to be in ministry, and then I got my first ministry job. I was 10 hours a week director of Christian education and 10 hours a week choir director for a small Methodist church in Morganton, North Carolina. And they had parking spaces for their pastors. And I was so excited because they were right up next to the door. You had the handicapped or assistance needed parking spaces. And then it was like pastor and then staff. And it was such a small Methodist church. It was just the pastor and me at the very beginning of our time together. And so every Sunday morning, I would pull in and I would park so proudly in my little staff spot. Now, there was a transition of senior pastors, and so when the new pastor came, I noticed that he didn't park next to me. And in fact, we had this long parking lot, and he would park all the way at the very bottom. I'm like, why is he doing that? Like it says here, pastor. And I thought, oh, it must be for his wife. He wants to leave his space open for his wife to come. And then on Sundays, at the end of the service, that spot would still be empty and his wife would have parked down as well. Finally, I asked him and got my little lesson in the ask. I'm like, why aren't you parking up here in the pastor's spot? And he said, I don't need the best parking space here. He said, in fact, I should take the very least. Now, he didn't have to go on and say, and so should you, like I knew that. He said, I'm not better than anyone else. In fact, like I get paid to do this, and it's my calling. So I want to leave that spot for somebody that's late or somebody that may need a closer spot than me. We're called to love. We're called to get along with others. We're called to not be stuck up. We're called to put ourselves underneath others as far as importance and power. And Paul goes on to say that in this chapter. I mean, he just like drives all this stuff home. He says, make friends with the nobodies. Make friends with the people because of who they are, not what they can get you. In the interpretation, the word nobodies is there, but I wanted us to look at that a little more in detail. Make friends with people because of who they are, not what they can get you. Don't be the great somebody. We need to love people who aren't loved by other people. Those are the folks that, as followers of Christ, like we should be the most intentional about. The people that are difficult to love, that's who we need to be intentional about loving. We aren't the great somebodies, and we're all in this together. And then when someone, Paul talks a lot about our enemies just like Jesus did. When someone hurts us, when someone's mean to us, Paul is very clear. He's like, look, just like Jesus said, love your enemies. Paul says, bless your enemies and don't hit back. Instead, discover the beauty in everyone. Don't try to get even. Discover the beauty in everyone. So like anytime you do a big event, we had, I think, around 850 students that showed up in 3.5 hours yesterday for school supplies and hot dogs and food and just books and clothes. And by the way, we collect all those things all year long and new tennis shoes. So if you see a great deal on a pair of tennis shoes at anywhere, we would welcome those shoes. We try to put like a $25 limit on it if you're going to buy them, you know, please try to stick to that realm, but and donate them just so like one child doesn't get a $100 pair of sneakers and another child get a $5 pair of sneakers, and we can't afford, you know, lots of hundreds of dollars of pairs of sneakers. But anytime you pull off an event that's that large, it's a lot. And you've got a lot of different people, and everybody's working, and everybody's exhausted. In fact, the West office will be closed Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday because Dawn, Lexi, and Lane have just worked so diligently. And then we have all our part-time people that work full-time, whether they know it or not, for West, like Josh and Brad and Pam. And they work so hard, and they don't get enough thank you, and there's not enough money to pay them what they're worth. But it's a big deal, the back to school bash. And I know that the staff feel like, oh my, it's coming. And then it's here and then it's over. And the good that comes from it is powerful, but the exhaustion that comes from it is also equally as powerful, especially when it's like, I don't know what the temperature was yesterday, but it was hot. And so personalities and tempers and energy can be draining, and I have a potential to get on people's nerves and, you know, miss things or whatever. One of the mantras that we adopt as a West staff culture that a wise mentor taught me years ago, and it goes along with the blessing of your enemies, is remember, everybody acts out of the best that they can for themselves. Like, none of us walk around wanting to be jerks or wanting to be buttholes. Like, we try, I mean, just in our general everyday life, like, I think everybody tries to do the best that they can do for themselves. Well, what your best is and what my best is may be different. And we get in trouble when we start having expectations for other people. And so, like, in Paul's words, he's like, try to look at other people with love and try to think about where they're coming from and quit judging. Bless your enemies and get the best of evil by always doing good. Remember, Aristotle said, you are what you repeatedly do. There's one more quote that I would like for us to think about. It is by the author of the book, The Power of Habit. And he talks about the fact that if we will do it and do it intentionally and do it over and over again, then all will be well because we will aim for goodness and love. As we close today, I want us to look at the Back to School Bash video, because remember, what we do over and over and over again, that's like who we are. And the power of habits, they're individual, but guess what? They're also corporate. And that's why I think it's the coolest job in the world to be the pastor of West Church. Because we are a church that, like, at 10 a.m. will not be gathering at the high school today. We have different teams of people that are going to be all over our county. Like, we're building a shed for a lady who is raising her grandchildren, and her daughter died tragically, and she just doesn't have the resources. So one of the guidance counselors in ISS put her in touch with our church, and so we're building a shed for her. We also are going to be unloading the trailer of the Back to School Bash. Like, instead of sitting around in our holy huddle at 10 a.m. this week, we're going to be out and finishing what we started yesterday and culminating a weekend of generosity and a weekend of intentionality by serving others. Now, you are worshiping on demand or online, and so you're like, well, what does that have to do with me? Well, we all have different ways and pathways that we can do for others. So, like, if you want to be a part of our No Huddles Day, like, go on Amazon. Look up Inspire Our Children. Find us on social media, the Back to School Bash. Inspire Our Children, and you can buy a pair of tennis shoes. We are always collecting those. Or go clean out your closet for the next 30 minutes. Or pull out some old books that you don't read and that you think somebody else would enjoy. And we have a storage unit now, so we're going to keep all that stuff there all year long until we're actually going to do two things this year. Bash for the teachers and educators in the middle of the year, and then we'll do the Back to School Bash next year. We are what we repeatedly do, and Paul says that in order to have that power, we need to be like Jesus, and we need to live from our center, and our center is love. How do we do that? Well, you actually make it possible by the way that you support West, by your financial contributions, by being a part, by watching this message and this video, by liking our stuff on social media. You make all this possible. So I want you to watch this video, and I want you to know that, like, you are living out of the center of love because you made something like this happen. Take a look.
Hey, it's Jewel Brown here, my third year helping with the Bash. I just like coming out here, meeting and greeting, talking to some of the students and looking at some of these bright-eyed future scholars and doing my part to serve the community.
My name is Tammy Wolf, and I just want you to know how amazing the Bash is. Many, many years ago when I went through a really bad divorce, about 11 years ago, I was a single mom of four girls living in housing and not being able to feed my children. And this Bash just picked up so much for me, helped me with my kids, helped me with the school supplies. I volunteered the very first year washing feet, and I've been here every year after. But I just want you guys to know, everyone that volunteers and everyone that gives and everyone that just donates things, you will never know how much it means to most of these families. It meant to me 11 years ago when I had four children, all in the Morrisville Grade School District, and I did not have the money to give them new supplies to start their school year, and how exciting it was for me to work and then be able to get school supplies so my kids could go to school just like all the other kids. So I thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Hi, my name is Sherry. This is my first year volunteering, and I'm volunteering with my daughter Naraya, and I thought it was just a good opportunity to get some community services.
Katie Law here today at the Back to School Bash. This is actually my first time volunteering here, but I've been a longtime supporter for a lot of years, and it has been a really cool experience with Christine because she's been volunteering here for a long time now. She's shown me the ropes, and I think the best part about it is just to see the kids' faces as they're getting their shoes. It's like the promise of a new school year. They're starting the school year out right, and they're so happy and excited and thankful to get this, and it's a blessing to be a part of it.
My name is Christine Beanstock. I've been volunteering at the Back to School Bash with my daughter for about 4 years. I love working with children, so like Katie said, to give them a backpack or give them new shoes and to see them excited about that fills my cup up, just like I think it fills their cup up, and I feel like the families really appreciate everything that we're out here doing.
It's great to see all the volunteers. There's a ton of people out here, and although it's very hot, it's very fulfilling.
This year I got a chance to work in the shoe section for the Bash, and I'm really excited because lots of my kids know that I love shoes. So this is a great way to serve the community beyond the school walls. I love giving back to our community. The people in our community have such great hearts, and they give so much to us, so being able to serve them just is really fulfilling.
My name is Hayden Stanley. I'm the director of this year's Back to School Bash. And the coolest thing I've seen this year is kids coming through and seeing the character backpacks and getting all excited about them to get one of those to bring to school next year.
I'm Noah Stanley. I'm the assistant director of this year's Bash, and the coolest thing I've seen this year is everybody's super excited to try on all the different shoe options they have.
I'm McKenna Ruggles. I'm the intern this year for the Bash, and probably the coolest thing that I've seen is all the kids back in clothing, finding just like stuff that they love.
My name's Emerson Eichelberger. I'm 15 years old. I'm a sophomore at MHS, and I think the Back to School Bash is really important because it gives kids a chance to have school supplies and just have a great time. And it's a good opportunity for our community to come together.
Hi, I'm Ember Nordine. I'm 15 years old and a sophomore at Morrisville High School. I volunteered for the bash because I think it's really important to give students a chance to come and see some of their friends and, you know, get school supplies and get clothes and stuff that they want, and still being at the school and, like, letting the community come together.
Hello, everyone. My name is Felicia Charles, and I am excited to be a part of the Back to School Bash. I can't tell you how important it is to go from a parent that was needing supplies for their child and didn't know where to turn. And Back to School Bash was that opportunity for my child to go to school fully prepared for the year. Going out of Back to School Bash for about 4 years now, where I have been doing nothing but the volunteer side of it, has been amazing and rewarding to see all the kids come through smiling about their book bag, smiling knowing that they're going to get shoes when they leave, and then they're seeing them wearing them at the school. First day of school is a blessing. So for me, as a parent that used to be the participant, there's nothing to be ashamed of. There's nothing to hide. This here is an amazing, it's a community outreach. I can't tell you how what of a blessing it is. And from someone that didn't know where to turn, Back to School Bash has been that safe haven for me. So I'm hoping this video or this message could help someone one day if you ever need anything for your children.
This year we provided over 900 students with backpacks, school supplies, shoes, books, and clothing.
And thank you to our over 200 volunteers for your help making this happen.
We are here for you. We love you. We pray for you. And if you need us, that's what we're here for. God bless each and every one of you.
We are what we repeatedly do. May we love from the center of who we are. May we not fake it. You know, yesterday morning I woke up and I was really, really tired. And I took vacation last week. I didn't think through the fact that we were on the West Coast. And so, like, my body at 4:30 a.m. yesterday would think it was like 1:30 a.m. because we'd only been back a couple of days. And we have some West folks in critical condition. And that weighs heavy on my heart. And I'm like, you know what? I don't need to go. They've got this. They don't need me there. I felt nauseous. I'm like, I don't want to go. And I'm like, okay, you have no reason to not go. And so you need to get over yourself and you need to suck it up and you need to go. Within being there, gosh, 10 minutes, I met some new people and we were putting out all the books. And their excitement and their energy and their love that they were putting out, like, it just infiltrated me. And it was actually one of the most amazing days, one of the most amazing bashes. And I haven't seen the video until just now. And to hear folks that came 11 years ago and now make it a part of who they are because, you know, they want to love from the center of who they are and they want to give back, like, okay. And to hear them talk about it's not about West Church, it's not about any other charitable organizations. Yesterday, we're all there and we're all one and we're all community. I'm pretty sure that's what the kingdom of God looks like. So thank you for being a part of our church and our organizations that work together to bring about love from the center of who we are. May that be our habit. May our habit be to always be looking for ways that we can give love. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, thank you for the privilege that we have to use our resources to make the world a better place. May that become our habit. May we find the things that get in the way of us being not our best selves. And God, may you help us address those things. See what our cues are. What are we really craving? And find new routines so that we can have new rewards that are positive and full of love and life. Thank you for giving us Jesus, the ultimate role model that shows us how to live from love, from the center of who we are, and let love and life be a habit. We offer ourselves to you. Amen. Thanks for joining in, and I mean it. Like, if you are worshiping from across the world or the United States, like Amazon.com, smile.amazon.com, Inspire Our Children is your nonprofit. Buy some tennis shoes or socks or school supplies and have them sent to us. We'll give them out in the middle of the year next year. Or go clean out your bookshelves or your closets. And because folks were so excited to get new books and clothes. We make serving others and loving others our habit at West Church. Thanks for being a part.